Price of Fear. Brought to you by Vincent Price. My little story for this week, I want to call Come As You Are. You know, that meaningless concession that gets added onto invitations to a party. You see, it's because the endless business of dressing up is such an integral part of my professional life that among my friends, my very positive reluctance to attend any kind of fancy dress party or costume ball is not only well established, but understandingly accepted. On a recent trip to London, I was genuinely delighted to find an invitation from my old friend Charles Vane awaiting my arrival. It wasn't until I'd reached that key and, to me, ominous phrase, fancy dress will be worn, that my heart sank. The fact that my would-be host had crossed it through and substituted the words, come as you are, afforded little by way of consolation. There can be few experiences so desultory as to find oneself sober-suited in the midst of a determined company of let's-pretend Casanovas, paunchy Tarzans, and moth-eaten King Kongs. As I put Charles's invitation back in its envelope, I'd already instinctively decided to decline. But even as I mailed my politely phrased refusal to his kind invitation, I had the distinct feeling that I was not to be let off the hook so lightly. The 2 a.m. phone call confirmed my misgivings. Hello.
Vincent, it's damn well not good enough, do you hear?
What? Oh, I'm sorry. Who is that?
It's not only not good enough, I'm damn well not going to take no for an answer.
Charles. Oh, Charles, is that you?
Surprise, surprise. Of course it's Charles. If Mohammed won't go to the mountain needs must. Anyway, who the hell else did you expect it to be?
Well, believe it or not, old thing, there are alternatives. Parents, relatives, friends, acquaintances. Oh, you'd be surprised.
Oh, would I? Well, yes. I just hope you're not in the habit of treating them in the same shoddy fashion, that's all.
Charles, delighted as I am to hear from you, you know it is the middle of the night.
Wrong again, Vincent, the early hours of the morning. But what's that got to do with anything?
Nothing, nothing at all, except that we mere mortals do rather count on a certain quota of sleep.
Mere mortals bore me.
Oh, yes, it slipped my mind. Please forgive the lapse.
I'm forgiving you damn all. Are you still there?
Still here?
It's on account of that damn stupid fancy dress bit, isn't it? So why do you think I changed it to come as you are in the first place?
Out of the question. The intimacies of my sleeping attire must remain a closely guarded secret.
Don't be skittish. In a way, all I hope is you had sufficient sense to keep the damn thing.
The damn... what, the invitation?
Yes, of course the invitation is what you're keeping me from my beauty sleep about.
I'm keeping you?
Yes, well, on the back you'll find a simple set of directions for getting here. A child of five could manage it. I've marked the priory with a damn big cross in the top right-hand corner.
The priory?
The house, my house. You will love it.
Oh, yes, I'm sure I would, Charles. But as a matter of fact, I have another appointment. A scriptwriter friend of mine is coming...
To hell with all scribblers, I shall expect you at 8.
But, Charles, I honestly don't see how
will
I can...
Will you let me get some sleep, damn you?
Charles, are you there? Charles? Charles? Oh, blast. Put to the test, Charles's simple set of directions might well have been comprehensible to a 5-year-old child. But not having one of them with me in the passenger seat, I spent hours exploring the same piece of countryside in ever-decreasing circles. I was just on the point of returning to London when I spotted the entrance to his drive. And within minutes, I was standing in the hall of one of the most remarkably beautiful houses it has ever been my pleasure to enter. The party was obviously in full swing.
Oh, there you are. Let the festivities commence. Vincent, you're late, damn it.
Oh, Charles, how good to see you.
I've been ringing that ridiculous hotel of yours for the best part of the evening.
What?
Thought you'd gone and funked out at the last minute.
Oh, I am sorry about that. Your directions weren't as explicit as you cracked them up to be.
Huh?
As a matter of fact, as a cartographer, your talents seem to be singularly lacking.
Nonsense. If Columbus had had me aboard, he'd have found the new world there one hell of a lot sooner than he did. Anyway, seeing as how you finally made it, come along into the library.
All right.
We'll fortify ourselves with a brandy or three before I introduce you to the somewhat dubious delights of the snake pit.
All right.
There you go, then.
Bye. Oh, I am sorry. Thank you.
Hey, you're miles away.
Yes, I'm just taking it all in.
The house? Yeah, impressive, isn't it?
Beautiful, Charles.
Cost me a pretty packet, I can tell you.
Really beautiful.
Point taken. Yeah, you're quite right, of course. The heathen financier in me. Always been under the impression they amounted to much the same thing. Anyway, here's to it.
And to your health and to your house. Tell me about it.
The Priory? Well, don't expect me to go into the full historic bit. But for all that, mentioned in the Domesday, one of the gems of early English monastic architecture, you know the kind of thing.
Well, I'm more than prepared to believe it.
Yeah, the domestic conversions came later, but it's still pretty exceptional. Anyway, I first fell in love with the place about 5 years back when I was a guest here at a party.
Oh?
A rather bizarre junkyard given by the wife of the then owner.
Oh, I see.
Well, I think she realized I rather coveted the place from the word go. And last season, we met up again in the south of France. She told me her lifestyle had changed somewhat since our last meeting, and judging by the bevy of young Apollos she had in tow, I was more than prepared to believe it. Well, I eventually got round to the house, and she said that, providing the figure was right, the place was mine for the asking.
Well, it obviously was, then.
Let's just say the contract was concluded to the mutual satisfaction of both parties, shall we?
You're the same old Charles.
So, here we are. 9 months later, and it's housewarming night on the old corral.
Thank you. Are you thinking of settling here?
Nothing surer. You look skeptical.
Oh, yes, I'm sorry.
My eye.
Well, you do have something of a reputation to live down, you know.
Well, you must give me 5 marks for effort, at the very least. I've already got so far as settling into the place. Even acquired a genuine English butler and a stable of splendid hunters. Yeah, every reason to be proud of my new country gentleman image, don't you think?
Well, all you need now is a genuine English rose to complete the picture.
I'm working on it.
You being serious?
I am. The question is she?
Oh, am I to meet her tonight?
Oh, my dear fellow, here tonight, her blue-blooded parents would have 40 blue-blooded fits.
Oh, then this is something of a last fling.
Let's just settle for the last but one, shall we?
All right, if you prefer.
I most certainly do. Right, let's be having you then. My lords, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the snake pit.
My original misgivings about accepting Charles's invitation proved well justified. Along with the disguises I'd anticipated, in a matter of minutes, I'd been introduced to a somewhat bibulous archbishop, an emaciated Theodabara on the decline, and the oldest bunny girl in the business. Charles's come-as-you-are concession proved a somewhat dubious advantage. My conventional business suit seemed to generate the same degree of cool hostility as if I'd elected to wear it at a convention of nudists. It was with a very positive feeling of relief that I eventually escaped the throng and sought out some corner strategically removed from the general merrymaking. The minstrel's gallery seemed perfect. Suitably fortified with a private bottle of Charles's excellent Dom Clicquot, I climbed to my remote perch as eagerly as any canary in its gilded cage, a positive refuge where I could ponder the idiot antics of my fellow man and consider myself well out of it.
And so you are, old fellow, so you are. Well out of it.
In the gloom of the gallery, I'd almost stumbled over the man. I managed a rather startled apology, but even when my eyes had grown accustomed to the darkness, the details of his physical appearance remained extremely vague. The quality of his voice, the spare, angular outline of the silhouette he presented, suggested someone of middle age, but then he could just as well have been a great deal older. Only for the briefest of instants was I positively aware of his pale, watery eyes, opaque behind the glint of his old-fashioned pince-nez.
I hope I didn't startle you.
Well, somewhat, I must confess. I didn't realize I was intruding.
A temporary refuge from the madding crowd, eh?
Yes, I know it must seem ungracious.
Oh, to some it might. For my own part, well, given the option, I'd have been abed and asleep hours ago. Oh, won't you take a seat?
Oh, thank you so much. Allow me to introduce
On these occasions, formal introductions always strike me as superfluous. On top of which, I can't offer my hand.
Oh?
A somewhat unfortunate accident.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that. If I were to fetch another glass...
Oh, it doesn't agree with me. But why don't you?
Oh, thank you.
I'm glad to observe that one of us at least had the courage to refuse being bullied into dressing the part.
Fancy dress. As in some ways it might have been easier to oblige.
The proverbial sore thumb, eh?
Yes.
In my own case, well, there was little option.
Oh?
My wife, you know. Huh? She positively revels in this kind of revel. But possibly you've already observed her. Hmm. Titania in all her glory.
Oh, yes. Yes, yes, as a matter of fact, I have.
It would be difficult not to.
Well, extremely effective.
Ridiculously pathetic.
What?
I can think of few sights so ludicrously tragic as a middle-aged siren aping the appearance and manners of a young girl half her age.
Mm.
Do I embarrass you?
Well, I...
Oh, you must forgive me, but her penchant for youth is so notorious. I now feel little reluctance to talk about it. Her companion this evening, for instance.
Oh, you mean the young man in the costume
you
of
have
Harlequin?
Him.
Yeah. Yeah.
Though the appurtenances of a gigolo might have been more appropriate.
Oh?
Her darling boy of the moment, Luigi del Potrello. The name means nothing to you?
Del Potrello. Oh, yes, it does sound familiar.
In most circles, it has a certain notoriety.
Ah.
The Potrellos are Italian merchants.
Oh, yes.
Extremely wealthy, hideously flamboyant, and totally without any distinction, taste, or breeding.
Mm.
Right from the outset, my home seemed in a perpetual state of siege. Billet doux by every post, secret assignations, ridiculously extravagant floral arrangements. And then the ultimate indignity of having the scoundrel pay court under my very roof, to be made constantly aware of their asinine sniggerings, their barely concealed whisperings, their grotesque fondlings, the middle-aged lovebird and her twittering young chick. But it wasn't until he started implanting his obscene influence on the house itself that my anger and frustration reached full spate.
How obscene.
Yeah, yes, obscene. Isn't it extraordinary how something as seemingly insignificant as a mirror can underline the absolute bathos of one's situation? Underline it with far greater emphasis than any of the indignities and infidelities that have gone before.
Well, I'm not sure that I understand. You did say a mirror?
Yes, one of his many gifts to her. A hideously ornate creation in the fashionable Florentine manner. You know the kind of thing. All gilt cupids, intricately entwined vine leaves.
Yes, I'm afraid I do.
Exactly, my dear fellow. Mm. Needless to say, quite out of keeping with the sober antiquity of my own furnishings, but a token of regard from her own darling boy, don't you see? And as such, to be blatantly hung in a place of honor. It seemed suddenly as if he were trying to destroy the very fabric of our lives.
Would it be impertinent of me to inquire?
What happened?
Yes.
No, but why not? It's probably common knowledge. The inevitable scene is the phrase that most readily springs to mind. But somehow, more significant than anything that had gone before.
Oh, Oh, you're exaggerating as usual.
I honestly don't think you realize
the gravity of the situation. Oh, come on, darling, say it. You can always be relied upon to trot out the obvious on these tedious occasions, can't you, my pet?
The occasion, as you choose to call it, might be a good deal graver than you think.
Oh, now you're beginning to sound much more like the old dodderer you really are. Well, come on, darling, don't stop now. It's the well-known visit to the headmaster you had in mind, isn't it? If so, you are achieving it to perfection. The darling boy really has excelled himself this time, hasn't he? Such an appropriate gift. A direct invitation to see yourself as you really are.
So why the hell don't you tell your darling boy he can take his bloody mirror right back where it came from?
We'll have to see, won't we, my pet?
And was the mirror taken back?
I presumed it must have been. I certainly don't recall seeing the damn thing again. But then, quite suddenly, that's to say, we both had more important things on our minds.
Oh?
I'd spent the day at the British Museum doing some research. I got home to find my wife had been taken seriously ill. In effect, a minor heart attack. Oh. I could only conclude it was a direct result of trying to keep up with her dissolute gadfly. Oh. The doctor advised that complete rest was absolutely essential. He also emphasized that there must be no undue excitement or shock. Yes, he particularly stressed the last bit, or shock.
Mm.
Even as he said it, it sounded strangely significant.
Why significant?
Well, as it turned out, I'd stayed up reading very late one night. I must have dozed off, because I was suddenly startled awake by a noise. It came from the head of the stairs.
What kind of a noise?
Difficult to describe, but a sort of bump, I suppose. Mm. A slight trip, perhaps. The servants had retired hours before. There was only my wife. At least, I believed that to be the case. Until...
Until?
I heard their voices coming from my wife's bedroom. I recognized Luigi's laughter immediately. Then, after a while, there was only silence. I think that silence was the most difficult thing to bear of all. For the first time, I admitted to myself that I had lost my wife to Luigi forever.
And your reaction?
How can one describe? Resignation, love, jealousy, hate,
yes.
All at the same time. I wanted her dead.
What?
I needed her dead. But had no notion how I could achieve it. I'm not a courageous man, not even an artful man. I returned to the study. And there, I saw something that seemed to suggest the perfect solution.
Yes, go on.
Shortly before her illness, I'd drawn my wife's attention to a book dealing with the medieval history of the house.
Yes.
Needless to say, she discarded it halfway through. But there was one particular section that not only claimed her interest, but held it in a state of shocked disbelief I'd never witnessed before. It concerned a ghost.
A ghost?
Most historic homes seem to lay claim to one. Knowing my wife's somewhat nervous disposition, I'd previously kept ours something of a closely guarded secret. But now, no undue excitement or shock, was what the doctor had said. There and then, I determined my ghostly inhabitant should serve his turn.
Well, what kind of a ghost?
The ghost of a Franciscan friar. Oh, the costume wasn't too difficult to improvise. A burnous, one of those Arab nightdress affairs, complete with hood, served my purpose to perfection. I put it on, lit a candle, left my study. I crossed the hall. The stairs creaked as I began to climb. I didn't mind. It only added to the theatricality of the scene I was about to enact. I could already imagine slowly opening the door of my wife's bedroom, hear her call out, "Who's there?" See the expression on her face as she watched in terror the specter of the Franciscan friar loom towards her. Perhaps one brief, terrified scream. And then I just reached the top of the stairs, was about to cross the landing, when I saw it, the actual spectre there, confronting me, the face shrouded in its hood, the candle flickering in its hand, the eyes, deeply socketed, stared accusingly into mine. For a long moment, there was only disbelief at what I saw. And then, panic. I tried to move, but couldn't. I tried to scream out, but no voice came. Then, with a newfound volition of its own, my arm lashed out with the heavy brass candlestick I was holding, lashed out at the ghastliness of that grizzled face. God help me. In the name of Christ, somebody help me.
For God's sake, man.
Oh, my God, Charles. Charles.
What the devil do you mean by slinking off like that?
I'm sorry.
Well?
I turned towards my distraught storyteller, but he was gone. Probably realizing he was in imminent danger of being forced back into the swinging multitude below.
Oh, come along, man. Don't just hang around in the gloom. There's somebody special I want you to meet.
From the far end of the library, Titania herself confronted me. She sat there enthroned in one of Charles's splendid high-back chairs.
Captain of our fairy band, mortals, darlings, close at hand.
As she misquoted from the bard, Titania made very short work of a very large brandy. In view of my so recent conversation with her husband, I must have looked somewhat taken aback. She was not slow to notice the fact.
Something worrying you, darling.
Well,
Charles, be a dear. Titania's running low on nectar. Well, darling, you were saying...
Light, I do apologize. It's pure coincidence, of course, but I've had the pleasure of making your husband's acquaintance.
My husband?
Yes.
You did say my husband?
Yes.
Oh, damn you, Charles. You haven't gone and told every Tom, Dick, and Harry my little secret. You know I particularly asked you to keep it strictly entre nous. Luigi would be furious.
Luigi? But that isn't your husband.
Oh, what a damn fool I am. Now I've gone and let the cat out of the bag. You must have been referring to that dreadful old dodderer I was imbecile enough to spend the best years of my life with.
Now, darling, we mustn't speak ill of the dead.
The dead?
Thank God. The best part of 2 years, isn't it, Charles? Even at the very end, the old dodderer proved as parsimonious and mean-minded as he'd been all along. Still, he paid for it. One of the few comforting things in life is that one can always depend on getting exactly what one deserves.
Or deserving exactly what one gets.
Oh, Charles, darling, you are being cynical. Anyway, I must away. Luigi has gone missing, don't you know? It isn't that I don't trust the darling boy, darling. It's simply that I don't. Goodbye, Mr.
Goodbye.
Charles, darling. Oh, it's been bliss. But Titania, darlings, must away to live and fight another day.
Yeah, what the hell was all that about?
Charles, tell me about him, her late husband.
Edward.
Was that his name?
Well, I only met the old stick once, and then very briefly, on my first visit to the place.
This place?
Well, of course, this was his house. He died here.
Where? Where exactly did he die?
You know, you look really peaky.
Answer the question, for God's sake. Please, Charles.
Well, as a matter of fact, at the head of the stairs.
The stairs leading to the minstrel's gallery?
Yes.
And the circumstances?
Oh, a bit unusual, really. It was Helen who found him. Apparently the old fool was on his way to bed, or got up in this ridiculous dressing gown thing of his when he spots this mirror.
The mirror? At the head of the stairs? It was Luigi's mirror, wasn't it?
Oh, has darling boy been telling you all about that?
Wasn't it?
Yes, a gift to Helen. The old boy raised such a stink about it, she locked it away at the back of a cupboard. Anyway, one night, after a somewhat torrid meeting with her darling boy, Luigi raises Coyne and insists on hanging it out in the open.
Directly at the top of the stairs. So that anyone coming up them would be bound to see his own reflection, wouldn't he?
Which is exactly what happened. Edward spots it, loses his temper, and smashes the thing to smithereens. Yeah, it was that that caused the heart attack, of course. Not to mention his hand.
What about his hand?
Severed. Quite severed. Extraordinary the violence that can be generated through a fit of jealousy, isn't it? I wish you'd have another brandy.
Will you tell me what he looked like, Charles?
Oh, Edward. Oh, do even better.
Charles handed me a snapshot. It was faded, but I spotted him immediately. One face among many, but I'd have recognized it anywhere. Not because of any particular feature, but because there, staring out at me, were the same pale, watery eyes, opaque behind the glint of his old-fashioned pince-nez. I handed the photograph back.
Oh, thanks. But might as well get rid of it.
Oh.
Not much point dwelling on the dead, is there?
No. Not much. Charles invited me to stay the night. I automatically refused. Some weeks later, he suggested we meet up again before he left on a business trip to the continent. The Priory was again suggested as a rendezvous. But in view of what had gone before, at the very last minute, I switched it to my hotel dining room instead. The decor hideously modern, the food bad, the waiters rude, the place positively bulging with people. I wouldn't have had it any other way.
That was Vincent Price, bringing you The Price of Fear. Co-starring in Come As You Are was Morris Perry, with Betty Huntley Wright and Peter Williams. Come As You Are was first recounted and dramatized by Bill Ingram and produced by John Dyer. Price of Fear, brought to you by Vincent Price.
Do you ever wonder what life will be like in, say, 50 years' time? I know I do, especially when I find myself becoming annoyed at some piece of modern tomfoolery. You know, the sort of thing, loud, mindless music being played unnecessarily in stores and restaurants. Checks long overdue because somebody's latest computer has made a mistake. This never seems to happen with bills, I notice. Well, I suppose we all have little likes and dislikes connected with various aspects of modern living, but most of us forget them after a brief flash of annoyance. That is, until the next time. The point I'm making is that we don't dwell upon them continually and become obsessed by them, for that way lies madness.
Take, for example, my story this week, which I've called The Ninth Removal. It concerns the case of Amelia Sidgwick.
These modern young girls, their clothes are an outrage. Short skirts, low-cut blouses, lipstick, disgusting.
My first, and thank goodness, my only encounter with Miss Sidgwick occurred when I called to see an old friend of mine, Peter Jarvis, in connection with some research I was doing for a film script I hoped to write. Peter was the head of a psychiatric clinic, and as I needed some background material on psychiatry, I had arranged to call on him one day at his office. I had expected a cold, cheerless, institutional building, but when I arrived, I was pleasantly surprised to find that the clinic was more like a well-appointed country house. I was greeted by a pretty receptionist, told to make myself comfortable, and that my friend Peter Jarvis would be available in a few minutes. Accordingly, I settled back in an armchair and picked up a magazine. Suddenly, I became aware of someone hovering over me.
Good afternoon. Are you being attended to?
Yes, I am. Thank you. I'm waiting to see Dr. Jarvis.
Oh, that's all right, then.
She was a tall, thin, scrawny woman of about 55 or so, dressed in a severely cut suit of dark gray material. She had a thin, white face with pinched lips and the most penetrating bright blue eyes that I have ever seen. Perhaps we would never have exchanged another word, but at that moment I happened to turn over the page of my magazine, and in doing so revealed a full-page advertisement, which showed a pretty, if overdeveloped, young lady wearing an incredibly low-cut dress.
Disgusting.
I beg your pardon?
That girl. Completely shameless. Just look at her.
I must confess, that's just what I was doing, looking at her. Now, you know, there are some people who have the happy knack of getting rid of bores and other awkward customers easily. Well, I don't. Perhaps I just don't like hurting people's feelings. You remember the rhyme of the Ancient Mariner, where the old sailor stoppeth one of three in order to tell him his long and complicated tale. Well, I'm the one of three, and Miss Sidgwick, having held me with her glittering eye, just took off.
Of course, you know, the men are every bit as bad. They encourage that sort of thing. Why, only the other day, I was travelling home in the underground when... God, how I hate the underground, crushed together in this awful atmosphere. I sometimes think that hell isn't a matter of fire and brimstone at all, but simply travelling forever on the underground, surrounded by awful people. Those men sitting there, so smug and oily-looking. Not one of them would dream of offering me his seat. Huh? Pigs, sitting there reading their newspapers. And what newspapers? Full of salacious muck. Headline there. Another sex murder victim found on common. Is it any wonder the way these modern girls dress? That one over there, crossing and uncrossing her legs. Oh. And that short skirt. Disgusting. Oh, she's smiling. Oh, yes, she's noticed that young man ogling her. I'd teach her. I'd take a whip to her. My dear father would never have allowed me to carry on like that. Dear father.
The devil's army is all around us, my child. Never forget it. You must fight it. Fight it with all your might. Never cease to fight for God.
I have fought, Father. Oh, how I fought for your stern God.
I sat there fascinated as Miss Sidgwick rambled on and on. At times she spoke clearly and precisely. At others she was almost incoherent with rage. Having at length described to me the trials and tribulations which she had suffered on the London underground system, she then went on to tell me about her work. Miss Sidgwick's employers had, it seems, been many and various. Her typing plus her sense of duty were beyond reproach. Employers might appreciate her work, but it seems to a man they were lovers of peace.
taking unkindly to criticism, and at length Miss Sidgwick was cast out, and with each casting out, her hate grew. One day, however, she joined a company run by a retired brigadier who had inherited his father's tea importing business. The atmosphere was middle-aged, quiet, and respectable, and the office staff adhered to the old ways of dress and deportment. As for the brigadier himself...
You see, the brigadier was a tall, distinguished, grey-haired gentleman, with both good looks and charming manners. He was not married, he did not smoke, and he was always extremely respectful towards his female employees. He was what I should call a gentleman of the old school.
From her manner, I guessed that Miss Sidgwick was not in love with the brigadier. It was just that she worshipped him.
Sometimes in my dreams I saw him standing a long way off on a hill. I saw myself running towards him, but the distance never seemed to shorten. In the same way as Father's God, he was always unreachable.
And so matters stood. Miss Sidgwick had at last found employment which suited her ideally, and an employer whom she could more than respect. And then one morning...
Miss Sidgwick...
Yes, sir.
Will you come in a moment, please?
Certainly, sir.
That's right, dear lady. Just come in and shut the door, will you? That's the ticket. Now, just take a seat. I have something to say to you. Now, the point is that I've decided to expand our little team.
Indeed, sir.
Yes, in fact, I've engaged a young lady. Excellent character. She's to join us on Monday.
I was not aware, sir, that you'd interviewed any applicants or even advertised the position.
No, you're quite right. But this young person was strongly recommended, most strongly.
I see, sir.
Needless to say, dear lady, I will look to you to see that Miss Franklin, that's her name, by the way, that she settles in happily.
I shall do my duty, sir, as always.
Of course you will, dear lady. That goes without saying.
The following Monday morning began very badly for Miss Sidgwick. On the underground, a large man stood on her toe. He was rewarded by a sharp kick on the shins. But there was worse to come. When she arrived at the office, she found her fellow workers in a buzz of curious excitement as they awaited the arrival of the new girl. It was a tradition in the company that newcomers did not start until 10 o'clock on their first morning, so there was plenty of time for speculation. Miss Sidgwick, however, refused to join in the speculations, even when approached directly by Mr. Parsons, the firm's junior filing clerk, a jovial man of about 45.
Well, miss, what about the new girl, eh? Do you think she'll be nice?
No, indeed. I should be greatly surprised if she is nice, as you put it.
Oh, dear.
However, as long as she does her work efficiently, I hardly think it matters whether she is nice or not.
Well, I was only wondering what she'd be like. What class of person, you know.
At best, I expect her to be tolerable.
Good morning.
Miss, can I help you?
I hope so. I'm Anne Franklin. I'm coming to work here.
I see.
Ooh, look at that. It's going to be a pleasure showing her the ropes.
Mr. Parsons, I suggest that you get on with your work. After all, you are being paid to do it. Miss Franklin, may I ask if that is your normal business attire?
Oh, the gear. Well, it's all I've got. I mean, I've got lots of clothes, but they're all like this. It's all right, isn't it? My last place didn't mind.
This is a respectable office.
I should hope so. Otherwise, I shouldn't have come to work here.
Ah, Miss Franklin, so you've arrived.
Good morning, sir.
My word, how fresh and smart you look. Like a breath of spring, eh, Miss Sidgwick?
If you say so, sir.
Yes, I do, dear lady. And now I'll leave Miss Franklin in your capable hands.
Yes, sir.
During the next few days, Miss Sidgwick could be likened to a lion in a cage with a succulent but stupid lamb, which the laws of creation had for some reason forbidden it to eat.
Oh, that stupid girl, flaunting herself, smiling at every man who comes within range. She even took to applying her lipstick during working hours. To this day, I do not know how I managed to restrain myself.
All these things might just have been bearable if it had not been for the girl's work. It was awful.
There we are. How's that, then?
No. This will not do, I'm afraid. There are 6 mistakes in this one letter alone.
Oh, dear, you are fussy.
And here, look, 3 misspellings. And last year's date. I'm sorry, but this will also have to be done again.
God, I've certainly made a hell of a bloody mess of that one.
What did you say?
Well, I mean, I've made a mess of it, haven't I?
Let it be understood, Miss Franklin, that foul language is not tolerated in this office. Neither is blasphemy. Do I make myself clear?
Yes, miss. Oh, I'm sorry, but you are a funny old stick.
What?
Nutty as a fruitcake.
This has gone quite far enough. I am going to see the Brigadier.
Suit yourself.
And so Miss Sidgwick stormed into the Brigadier's office and there presented him with the full catalogue of her complaints against the pretty young newcomer. His reaction, however, was not quite what she had expected.
Alas, the youth of today, Miss Sidgwick, does not adhere to the principles we treasure.
But you do not see, sir. Blinded by your own goodness, you do not see. She bears her flesh, she paints her face, she encourages men. Why, Mr. Parsons has hardly been himself since she came here. In addition to which, she cannot type.
I too, Miss Sidgwick, deplore the lax morals and lower standards of this permissive age. But dear lady, you and I can't fight the world.
Oh, correct me, sir, if I am wrong, but surely a soldier who believes in his cause never ceases to fight.
True, very true. But when defeat is certain, he changes his tactics. He pretends to surrender, infiltrates the enemy's ranks, and becomes an underground force.
Oh, but that... She insulted me. She should be cast out.
That, dear lady, would be to admit defeat. Now, I'll tell you what. Ask her to come and see me, will you?
You will chastise her, sir.
Appealing as the prospect is, dear lady, I fear that I shall have to content myself with a reprimand on this occasion. Thank you for bringing the matter to my attention.
Thank you, sir.
And Miss Sidgwick?
Yes, sir.
You are my strong right arm. Never forget that.
Oh, sir.
And remember, infiltrate the enemy's ranks, dear lady. Infiltrate the enemy's ranks.
Oh, yes. Yes, indeed, sir. I'll remember.
For the rest of that day, Miss Sidgwick, it seems, basked in a golden haze, remembering the Brigadier's words.
You are my strong right arm, dear lady.
Oh, I am. I am.
By tea time that day, Miss Sidgwick had even unbent sufficiently to spend a few moments chatting with Mr. Parsons and Miss Franklin about the latest topics of interest.
Oh, no, Mr. Parsons. I don't think that sort of thing could ever happen here. We breed a much better type of politician. There's so much more background.
Listen to this in the paper. Another of those sex murders. A girl of 19 found brutally murdered on Wimbledon Common. This is the 8th victim to be struck down in the past 2 years. Ugh, gives me the creeps. Whoever does it must be kinky.
Poor girl. I wonder why so many of these attacks take place nowadays.
I can tell you. It's because these modern girls ask for it. Short skirts, lipstick, low-cut blouses. Is it any wonder they get assaulted?
Assaulted, I can understand. But murdered. Ugh.
Miss Sidgwick was about to launch herself upon a lengthy and angry tirade concerning Miss Franklin and all girls like her when she remembered the Brigadier's words.
Infiltrate the enemy's ranks, dear lady.
Isn't it strange how great disasters often have humble beginnings? A smoldering cigarette end tossed carelessly aside, and an entire building burns down. Or a cat runs across a busy street, a bus swerves, and someone is killed. Well, that night on her way home, Miss Sidgwick suddenly realized that she had forgotten her umbrella. Now, Miss Sidgwick without her umbrella was like a D'Artagnan without his sword. Her umbrella, apart from its proper use, was also invaluable on occasions for shin-cracking or rib-poking. And so, muttering angrily to herself, she retraced her steps to the now deserted office. But was it deserted?
That's strange. A light in the Brigadier's office. Well, I wonder, can he be working? He didn't say anything. No, silly of me. Perhaps he's just forgotten to turn off his light.
Oh,
what's that? Oh, dear. Dear, perhaps I'd better investigate. Whoever it is has left the brigadier's door open. I wonder if I can see.
Charles, this is cozy. Just the two of us.
Just the two of us. Kiss me again, Anne.
Greedy.
Miss Sidgwick stood there and stared in horror. The brigadier and Miss Franklin were far too occupied to notice the white face staring at them through the open doorway. To say that Miss Sidgwick was in a state of shock would be to put it mildly. She left the building quickly and began to walk.
I walked a long way that night, through Panton Street into Leicester Square, back again into Piccadilly, through the seedy streets of Soho, and everywhere, everywhere, the voice of corruption screamed at me from hoardings, bookshop windows, cinema posters, from the white, leering faces of men and the painted faces of the women. At last, I came to a small square surrounded by iron-backed seats. I sat down. By now, the numbness I had felt since leaving the office had passed. I remember I sat there, sobbing, feeling like a lost child in a strange land, alone in a city peopled by my enemies. And I thought of my father.
The devil's army, fight it, my child, fight it.
And of the brigadier as he used to be.
Infiltrate the enemy's ranks, dear lady.
I heard the laughter of the men and the women, the noise of the traffic passing by. I cried out, why am I forsaken? Then an awful thought came to me. Could it possibly be that I was mad? Hurriedly, I pushed the thought to the back of my mind. Then I imagined I saw rows and rows and rows of faces, laughing, leering, grinning faces. I wanted to smash them! Smash them! Smash them!
The next morning, I gather, saw Miss Sidgwick back at her desk, as usual. She rebuked Miss Franklin for her bad typing and greeted the brigadier with reserve. From that time on, she watched both of them, much as a stoat watches a pair of well-fed rabbits, keeping meticulous note of their movements. Each day, she carefully examined the brigadier's desk diary. At last, her vigilance was rewarded. She discovered in the diary an entry for the following Wednesday evening. The brigadier had written AF, followed by an exclamation mark. The question was, where would they meet? Miss Sidgwick decided to make certain. On that Wednesday evening, she followed Miss Franklin almost to her front door. Then she hid in the shadows and prepared to wait. To wait, if necessary, for hours. In fact, her vigil lasted barely half an hour. Then Miss Franklin came out of the house and began to walk towards the nearby underground station. Miss Sidgwick followed.
I remember she was hurrying, but it was quite easy, really, to keep up with her. I followed her along the passage and along the tunnel that led to the ticket office. I can see her now. She was wearing a blue two-piece costume with an incredibly short skirt. She wore high-heeled shoes and she carried a white handbag, which she swung as she walked along. When she reached the platform, she almost stood at the edge, doing a little impatient jigging dance as she waited for the train to arrive. The platform was fairly crowded, and I was able to get so close to her that I could smell the cheap perfume she'd obviously drenched herself with. As we waited for the train to arrive, the platform became more and more crowded. I moved closer to her. I began to feel strange, warm excitement. Then, as the train drew nearer and nearer, I leaned forward. You little slut! You have corrupted God! At the same time, I pushed her hard. Nobody saw me do it. The platform was too crowded. Then I stepped back and was immediately lost in the crowd as it surged forward. I left the station, made my way back to the office where I knew the brigadier would be waiting. Waiting for her.
So here you are at last. Miss Sidgwick. What are you doing here? Is something wrong?
No.
I'm sorry, I don't understand. Is there something you want to tell me?
Yes.
I see. Sit down, won't you? No? Well, I'm afraid whatever it is, we'll just have to wait until morning. I have an important engagement tonight.
No, sir, you have no engagement. Miss Franklin, that slut, will not be coming here tonight.
What the devil do you mean?
I saw you, both of you, that night. And since then I've watched and waited. Then tonight, I struck.
I see. Miss Sidgwick, I think perhaps you'd better sit down. But first, I suggest that you put down that obviously lethal weapon you've been trying to conceal beneath your coat.
Please do as I say, at once.
I'm not accustomed to having my orders disobeyed. Thank you. A dangerous-looking knife, dear lady. Where did you get it?
I bought it at the ironmonger's. Nobody knows I've got it. Nobody saw me.
I take it that you did not use it on poor Miss Franklin.
No. I pushed her under a train.
Ah. Did anybody see you?
No. Well, that is, I don't think so. It will look like an accident.
Well, I suppose we must be thankful for that. Miss Sidgwick, I'm very displeased with you. Did I not say to you in this very office not so long ago that you were to infiltrate the enemy's ranks, act as they do?
Yes, sir, but I'm not interested
in your excuses. I only want to know why you took it upon yourself to make what I can only describe as managerial decisions. I am the general in this army, Miss Sidgwick, and I alone make the decisions. But I decide who is to be removed. Do I make myself clear?
I'm so sorry. I don't understand.
Being sorry would not have been much comfort if you had brought disaster on my entire campaign by your thoughtless and ill-conceived actions, dear lady. I had great plans for you. Great plans. In time, I might well have allowed you to work in the field with me. Oh. But now, how can I ever trust you again?
Oh, please, please trust me. Oh, please.
It's been a glorious campaign so far. 8 of them I've removed. The last one on Wimbledon Common. And the fame of my work has been proclaimed throughout the country. Front page stuff, too. Oh. They came to me, flaunting their bodies. Young, eager. For a while, I became as they were. Then I struck. I took them to lonely places. And then... And you, Miss Sidgwick, have interfered. You have destroyed the ninth removal.
Oh, I'm so very sorry, you said. I didn't know. Please, please forgive me. Oh, please.
I do forgive you, dear lady. For I see now that you only acted with the very best intentions.
Oh.
Yes, I forgive you. We have a great task before us, you and I. For you see, dear lady, there are so very many more to be removed.
I sat there in that comfortable, warm waiting room, listening to Miss Sidgwick pouring out her dreadful, monstrous, unbelievable story. I sat there stunned, not daring to look her in the face. Then, suddenly, I was roused from my daze by the arrival of my friend, Dr. Jarvis.
Hello, Vincent.
Oh, hello, Peter.
So sorry to have kept you all this time. I got held up in a difficult case. Hello, Miss Sidgwick. You here?
Yes, sir. I'm just going. I only looked in to see that everything was as it should be. Well, goodbye. It's been so nice to have someone to talk to.
Well, goodbye.
Bye-bye, dear lady.
Peter, that woman, is she safe? I mean...
Miss Sidgwick?
Yes.
Yes. Safe as houses. Interesting case, though. I must tell you about it sometime.
Yes. Yes, you must.
I say, you all right, old man? I say, you do look a bit seedy. Fancy you getting stuck with old Ma Sidgwick.
Excuse me, Dr. Jarvis.
We were suddenly interrupted by the arrival of a very pretty young blonde. As she came towards us, I experienced, for a moment, a strange sense of unreality. For I saw that she was wearing a blue 2-piece suit with an incredibly short skirt, She was carrying a white handbag and wore high-heeled shoes.
Sorry to disturb you.
Yes?
I've left the papers for the Peabody case on your desk, but I wondered what you wanted to do about these two, Fredericks and Wilkinson. You did say they were urgent.
Good Lord, so I did. I've forgotten all about them. Thank you for reminding me. I'm not going to have any time today. I'll tell you what. If it's all right with you, why don't we stay on late this evening? Get them cleared away. Who knows? If we get finished quickly, I might even reward you by taking you out to supper. I know a nice little restaurant out near Wimbledon Common.
That would be nice. Thank you.
Right, Miss Davis, let's settle then. Well, come along, old man. You can't stay here ogling our Miss Davis all day. I'll have some coffee sent into my office. We can talk in peace there. Come on, we've got work to do.
And work we did. Peter proved a mine of information concerning psychiatry, and I listened to him carefully and made copious notes, but somehow, after that visit, I didn't feel that I had the heart to carry on with my film script. I felt, to put it mildly, out of my depth. And so, having thought about the whole thing carefully, I decided that, all things considered, it might be better if I stuck to something simple. It might, I thought, be safer to write a cookery book, for example, and that's exactly what I did.
That was Vincent Price, bringing you The Price of Fear. Also starring in The Ninth Removal were Frieda Jackson and Richard Pearson, with Claire Sutcliffe, Michael Siegel, and Alan Rowe. The Ninth Removal was first recounted by R. Chetwynd Hayes, dramatized by Barry Campbell, and produced by John Dyers.